folks, I'm Matt, and welcome to my top 100 board games of all time. Man, am I excited to finally get this out. I watch YouTube videos all the time of people's top 100, and I get to learn so much of other board games that way, and I always love hearing what other people love to play. I also found out that my interest is a lot different than all of them. By the way, if you're looking for vintage games, I made a top 80 vintage games of all time. So if there's a game you're like, Matt, I thought you loved that game, it's probably on my vintage game list. I do have a few vintage games on my top 100, but not that many. And also I have some children's games, because remember, I play with my nephew some of these games. And then I just have some odd games that no one else has. So like I said, one of the reasons I love watching the YouTube videos is to find a game I never knew about and try it out. So hopefully I can do the same for one of you viewers. All right, so let's go ahead and get things started. I want to mention there is only one game that fell out of my list that's not a vintage game, and the game was number, I think I had it ranked 87 last year. It was called Castle Panic. It's a co-op game, a lot of fun, mainly for a young adult audience, and so I donated the game to a friend of mine so he and his family could play, and they have a great time with it, so I'm glad it found a good home. But it's not on my list. It's actually completely off my list. Now, just like last year when I made this list online, I had a hard time deciding which number 100 game I should put in this slot. And I had three potential candidates for the position. So I'm going to talk about the two runners up here. One was kind of an easy decision at first, but Timber Tom is a game that I reviewed where you have all these trees and you're planting trees and moving up one of the four mountains on each corner of the board and collecting that treasure and then making it back to the cabin, you know, home base. I love that game a lot, and me and my nephews love playing it. Unfortunately, there aren't enough trees in the game to play the full game. We have to kind of borrow trees from other places on the board, and that is not cool. I even have the Woolamite Trees expansion, and it's still not enough trees. They could give me double the trees, and that would barely be enough. Another reason it didn't make the top 100 is I've had to house rule a lot of the rules. One of them that you don't, there are some wonderful cards in this game, and you don't get to play them that much. And so we house ruled it to where you're going to be able to play a few more cards, which makes the game better. Unfortunately, not having enough pieces or trees to complete a full game, it didn't make the top 100. The other one just got switched out last night, and I might switch it back, I'm not sure. But right now, it didn't make it. It was Banana Party by Queen Games. It's a children's game where you basically have this divider, and people hang these monkeys on these pegs, and you're twisting the pegs to see if you guessed if the monkey was on that peg. If you were right, the monkey falls off, and you get banana chips, and whoever has the most bananas wins. It is a fun, simple little kids game that my nephews and I love to play, and it just barely missed the list for my number 100, which is Stargate SG-1, the board game. And this game, it's basically area control, as you are controlling an armada of ships and an army of troops out across the board to control a certain amount of sectors in the game. And if you control X amount of sectors at the end of the round, you win the game. Now, this game does not scale well. You should only play it with 6 players, the maximum players, because anything less than that, there's going to be one open sector that no one's going to fight for. And whoever can claim that sector, you know, who's sneaky enough not to get into a battle, will win the game. And that's in 2, 3, 4, 5 player games I played. The only time this works is at 6 players. Now, I had this game ranked at number 93 last year on my list, and for the same type of reasons. It still holds on into my top 100 right here at number 100, and that's because my gaming group are all Stargate fans along with myself. Now, the pieces in the game look really nice. They look really cool. They're different molds, too. I think there's 3 different molds copied twice among different colors in the game. So there's a lot of nice, shiny-looking plastic with this game, but the game doesn't scale well. 6 players, though, it's a fantastic game. I love playing it, and that's why it's number 100 on this list. Number 99 is Roadhog. And Roadhog, you are a car trying to make it through traffic, through all these tiles, and trying to get to the exit. The first one to do that will win. Now, there's dice you'll have to roll that will tell you what cards you can move around, cards you can play to help yourself or to hurt other players. And basically, you're bobbing and weaving through traffic trying to get to that exit. And it mimics actual traffic, actually driving through Atlanta. If anyone's ever drove through Atlanta, where you have to weave and you're running through eight lanes of mayhem, that's what Roadhog feels to me. Now, in my review, I called this a game for children, and I had a few people make comments on the video that said, actually, Matt, it's for adults too. You should try it out with your gaming group. I have been trying to do that, but unfortunately, no one in my gaming group wants to play it. I have one more gaming group coming this week, and I'll try to see if they want to play it. But to everyone else, it looks a little too simple and doesn't seem to have that much playability for adults. Now, I could be wrong on that. It just could be my gaming group. My nephews and I love the game. It's a lot of fun. It's a very simple game, and there aren't enough cars in the box that they give you, and that's easily solved because once all the cars pass the first tile, we just pick up those cars and apply them to some of the later tiles who require cars, but there's just not enough in the box to go around. That kind of irks me a little bit. But honestly, the game, like I said, it simulates, you know, going through traffic, driving after five, trying to get off your exit, you know, bobbing and weaving through traffic, like I said. I love that aspect of the game. Now, it would be more realistic if you could stop someone behind another car, but that is virtually impossible to do in this game. The times we have played this, that has never happened. We've tried to box someone in, but they can always get out. But I think that's good for the game, because how much fun would it be if it was your turn and then you couldn't move and they had to skip your turn and go to someone else until traffic moved around you? That wouldn't be fun. It'd be thematic, but it wouldn't be fun. So it needs to be wild, it needs to be crazy, and that's what this game is, and that's why it's number 99 on my list. My number 98 is Kimball's Cascade by Z-Man Games. And this one, it plays like an old arcade game where you're a spaceship scrolling up this deck of cards, shooting asteroids, enemy ships, and then, of course, at the end, a mothership, which takes up basically half the board. I like the idea of this game. I like the little trays that you use to scroll down the board, and it's an ever-scrolling board until you get to the end. I like how you're making upgrades to your ship the entire time, and that no one ship will ever be the same. And people go in different routes to customize their ship, and I like that they give you a ton of choices to choose from. Now, last year I had this game ranked at number 35, so it's fallen 63 spots here on my new list. And the reason for that is this game takes way too long than is justified for, meaning that the game we play takes almost 3 hours most times, every time we played it. And I don't know why that is. The game, like I said, it doesn't justify the pieces, the gameplay. I don't know what takes us so long to finish this game, but every game is definitely over 2.5 hours and almost to 3. And that's just a little too long for this game. Don't get me wrong. I still love the game. It's still on my list here, but that's why it dropped a little bit at 98. At 97 is a new game in my collection. It is Santorini. Santorini, you are basically, it's an abstract game where you're trying to build these cities and get your little pawn to the top of that little tower. The first person to do that wins. You are Greek gods and goddesses, so you have special abilities that can help you or hurt other players. And after it's over, the board looks beautiful. This is a beautiful looking game. My nephews, when we were at BGGCon this past year, they begged me to get this game for them because they wanted to play it. And so the very last day, we finally got it. We sat down, we played it. They absolutely loved it. It's one of their top favorite games they've ever played. Now, for me, I love it too, not as much as they do. I don't really like abstract games, but I will say this. If you add the Golden Fleece expansion to that, that does add something more to it that I really love. So I would like to play this game, but with the expansion, the Golden Fleece expansion. Santorini is still fun. I have it in my collection. I'm super happy that it's in my collection. Whenever my nephews come over, we're definitely going to play it. And I've played it with my adult board game group as well, and they have enjoyed it too. So there you go, Santorini, number 97. Number 96 is Russian Crush. Now, Russian Crush is a futuristic racing game where you have these tiles you're placed out around the board. You can have one long trek, or you can have actually a circuit that you move around. And what you're trying to do is you're trying to destroy your opponent and cross that finish line. Russian Crush is a super cheap game. I see it everywhere for really cheap. I picked it up. I was like, well, man, for $15, it can't go wrong, right? And I'm happy I did. I really like the mechanics of the game, all the dice rolling, that the faster you go, the less control you have over your vehicle. I think that's very thematic. We have played this game only once this year. We played it a lot last year, which is why it's fallen a little bit on this list. Last year I had it at number 59, so it dropped about 37 spots. And the reason for that is I just had a ton of other new games, you know, injected into my collection. And so for that reason, I think that's why Russian Crush fell a little bit. Because, as I said, I've only brought it to the table once this year. It is a fun game, though. I love playing it. And we haven't even gotten to all the choices that you have with all those tiles. So there's lots of gameplay left in it for me. And that's why it's number 96 on this list. My number 95 is a new game to the list. It's called Incognito. Incognito, your spy is in Venice. And it's a four-player game, or five-player, I guess, depending, where you have four different spies, and you're all trying to find out who your partner is, because two of them are not your partner, one is. It's a big game of, you know, fake and double fake. You deceive some people while all the while you're trying to figure out who your partner is. You want to know that because at the beginning of the game, there's four different pieces to a plan. And whatever combination that you have and your partner has makes a certain mission or goal in the game that you have to achieve. And so you'd look at your little player shield and it would tell you once you knew what the plans were. And how you do that is you have to meet with these different colored spies and exchange cards. When you go to them, you interview them or interrogate them, and they have to give you your choice of their height or their characteristics or who they are. And so they will give you two cards that are lies and one that is truth, or at least one that's truth. They can give you two truths if they want to. Heck, they can give you all three truths if they want to. But they have to give you one of those cards has to be true. And they can't give you the same cards, because if they repeat it, then they have to take one away and it's 50-50 from there on out. So what you're trying to do is everyone's trying to feel each other out to see who is their partner, who they can trust. Once they find that person, then they got to complete their goal. I love this game. It is so unique. I actually showed it to my gaming group, and one guy went out and bought himself a copy as well, and he's played it several times. It pops at number 5 only because I have a certain problem with the game. It seems like every time somebody, and that somebody has been me too, has passed three cards to a player, and unknowingly all of them were lies. And they knew what the rules were, and they just forgot. And I handed three lies to someone, I think the first game we played, and then the last game we played was a few months ago. Someone handed me three lies and totally confused me, because I was for sure they were my partner. But when they handed me those three cards, like, oh, they're not my partner. And we walked around really confused, all of us did, because no one knew who, I guess he may have done that to a few other players too. And so no one knew who anyone was, and the game drug a little bit. But if played properly, Incognito is a fantastic game, and that's why it's number 95 on the list. My number 94 is a children's game, but has a lot of tension and is a lot of fun, has some really smart decisions you have to make in the game as well. It's called Sharkmania. In Sharkmania, you're pirates running away from a shark fin that is busting up the pier. And if it gets to you, you're out of the game. So when you roll the die, you need to move down that pier as fast as you can. But wait, you also have a choice when you roll the die to grab that many coins off the table instead of moving spaces. So it's an either or type of game that you have to make the right decision at the right time. If you start getting too many coins, that shark fin looks like it's never going to get you, and then all of a sudden, bam, it's right on top of you and you're out of the game. Or if you ran all the way to the island, then your game is over, and if you didn't get any coins, you're not going to win. Coin values range from 1 to 3, so even though you may have more coins than someone else, if their values are worth more, they could still win the game. I love this game. It is very simple. It is a very quick game to play. I play it with my nephews, but I also play it with my gaming group. I do a lot of theater, and so this is the game that I bring backstage. It's easy to set up, easy to teach, and fun to play, and people, we play a few rounds at intermission together, and it's such a great game. I'm just shocked that a children's game is this good. Last year I had on this list at number 72, so it dropped about 22 spots, and that's only because I have a bunch of new games that entered my collection. So for it to only drop 22 spots isn't that bad. So Shark Mania, my number 94. My number 93 is a game that's been around for a while, but it's new to me. It's called Machikoro. In Machikoro, you're rolling these die and getting benefits from certain cards you have or other cards that other players have in the game. And of course, you're trying to use those benefits to get some coins to unlock certain special ability cards. Once you've unlocked the last one, you win the game. I don't like this game as just the base game. I find it kind of boring and repetitive. But if you add the expansions, or I think Target had the City Lights and Brights, the dark blue box, that's the one to get because it has all the expansions in it and adds a lot of variety in the game. And it makes every game different and unique. And I really do enjoy that. Machikoro, simple game, easy to understand, easy to teach, and incredibly fun to play, which is why it's my number 93. Number 92 is another new game to my list. It is Here Kitty Kitty. Here Kitty Kitty has you bringing in stray cats into your lawn, into your porch, into your house even. And the closer you can bring them inside, the more points you get. You also get points for setting up different combos of cats in your house as well. And of course, you're trying to be the craziest cat owner by having a million cats come in to your doorstep. It is a weird theme. There are these little plastic cats in it that are just really fun. I actually played this game at Gen Con last year when it came out. My buddy bought a copy. I waited, and I shouldn't have because they all sold out. And he loves the game. It's one of his top games of all time. Of course, he's a cat person. I'm not a cat person. This past year, when I was looking at getting some small game to get that $100 free shipping, you know, I said, what game can I get? And then I remembered, oh, wait, Here Kitty Kitty. I'll get that one. So I grabbed that one in. It is a fun game. My wife likes it. Some of my board game group enjoys playing this as well. It is just a simple little fun game and well worth my time. And it's number 92 on my list. At number 91 is Roadkill Rally from Z-Man Games. In this game, you are racing fast and furiously through a bunch of tiles that give you different abilities and also have different pedestrians on the tiles to where you can hit them. That's right, you get points for running over pedestrians. But wait, you get extra points for running over kids and big points for running over little grannies and strollers. Oh my goodness, the little pawns for them are so awesome. I love all the little models. Running them over is fun. Not that I want to run over people in a car. I'm just saying the theme of this game, and it jokes upon itself. You're shooting other players, you're trying to finish this race, and you're trying to run over as many people as you can. It's roadkill, baby. I really do love the game. I introduced it to my gaming group last year. A buddy of mine went ahead and bought himself a copy as well because it's really cheap to find online. And it is a mindless, fun racing game. Race them and shoot them up game at the same time. The first time you play this game, it may take you a little bit longer because you're going to have to get used to reading the tiles and understanding what the cards mean. But after the first few plays, you've got it down pat and you start playing 9-0. It is a super fun game. Last year I had it on my list at number 54. So it went down about 37 spots. And that's because probably all my other new games I got in my collection kind of forced this one down, even though this one has hit the table a couple of times. So who knows, maybe it'll go back up next year. But incredible game, my number 91. All right, folks, that's it for right now. Hey, come back and see me as I go over my top 90 games of all time. See you then.